प्रवीण सर, कैन यू हियर माय वॉइस सर?
यस सर, यस सर,
गुड आफ्टरनून, गुड आफ्टरनून सर। वी कैन वेट 2 मिनट्स एंड वी कैन स्टार्ट सर। स्टूडेंट्स काइंडली इन्फॉर्म योर फ्रेंड्स आल्सो टू जॉइन फास्टली इन दिस वेबिनार। Both second year and final year students, please inform to your in your groups. So far we have 17. Okay, if you have any class during now that 2:30 to 3:30, you need not to join. Students who have class, you can go to your class. Okay, so other than free students, you can join here. So Praveen sir, shall I start?
Yes sir, you can start.
Yes. Okay, so very good afternoon to everyone. So it is a great privilege for me to introduce our special speaker, who is Mr. Y. Praveen Kumar sir. So sir is currently a principal in Telangana, in Sri Venkateshwara Paramedical College, and today's topic gonna be automation, pre-analytical automation, and sir will take over the session. So please start, sir. Sir, I'm getting sharing option, sir.
Yes, sir. I'm getting the option.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir, for the introduction. Okay. Yes, good afternoon, students. Good afternoon, everyone. Sir, someone is Vamshi sir, can you hear me?
Yes sir, I can hear you sir.
Sir, I lost that sharing option.
You'll just wait sir, let me check here. Sir, in which account you are using computer sir? Praveen Gresh sir,
yes,
is it?
I got it. No, I got it now.
Okay.
I got it now.
All right.
One second.
Yes sir, we can see the PowerPoint. Yes sir.
Yes. Okay, good afternoon everyone. So there is no need of my introduction for everyone. Actually it was going on from the last 2-3 days, and Vamshi sir also has given my introduction in the starting of this session. So I am directly going to the topic. So today our topic is about pre-analytical automation. So normally whenever we are collecting a sample from a patient, we will take that, after collecting the sample, we will move that sample to the laboratory, and inside the laboratory we will be hearing about manual methods or automated methods. Sometimes we will run the sample with the help of manual procedures, and sometimes we will use the machines and we will run the sample and we will get it. So here in this updated technology, we are also having some type of special machines to perform the things which we are collecting the blood sample and moving the sample to the laboratory. All these things are also performed by the automated machines. So pre-analytical, before the analytical process has begins, there is some process like collecting a collection of sample and recording of the patient details properly, and separating the samples for biochemistry laboratory, and separating the samples for microbiology laboratory, and separating the samples for hematology laboratory. So like this, there are different types of steps. So till now, manpower is we are utilizing the manpower to perform all this type of tests, but there are some automated machines which will perform all these things. Okay, so today in our topic, we are going to discuss about that pre-analytical automation procedures which are done before the sample enters into the laboratory by the machinery. So first, let me tell you what is actually automation. In a simple words, an analytical instrument will do the work with only minimal involvement of the manpower. This is a simple definition of the automation. Automation is nothing but here we are using some analytical instrument, we are using some instrument, and it will do the work. And here we don't need so much of manpower. Okay. So, and it will process a large workload. A human can perform around 100 tests per day. Then a machine can perform around 10,000 tests per day. So it can process a larger workload. And there is no increase in the staff. No need to pay high salaries and no need to pay more salaries for the more number of staff. With the help of automation, we can have less number of staff, and we can test more number of samples in a single day. And it can reduce the errors. Errors means mistakes. Sometimes when we are collecting the sample, you may note the patient details wrongly. You may write the name wrongly, or you may write the age wrongly, or sometimes you may note that tests which are to be performed on the patient, you may note that test says wrongly. So there are different types of chances where you can make errors. So when you are using this automated machines, you can reduce that errors. These are the benefits of automation. Automation is nothing but the machine will do the work inside the laboratory with the help of less manpower, and it will give a benefit to the laboratory by processing the larger workload and with less number of staff and by reducing the errors. So moving to the next, the automation is classified into three types: pre-analytical automation, and analytical automation, and post-analytical automation. So let me tell you what is pre-analytical automation. Pre-analytical automation means first, we are collecting the sample from the patient. That will be done by the machine. After collecting the blood from the patient, or sample, or it may be urine, or it may be CSF or anything. After collecting the sample from the patient, we will note down the details. Even the details are also noted by the machine. Okay. Then the sample should be transported to the laboratory, because in the bigger hospitals, the sample collection center will be at the ground floor and the laboratory will be at the top floor. For some bigger laboratories, the laboratories will maintain some collection centers because every patient cannot reach the laboratory. Okay, so transporting of samples is also a very, very important procedure in the laboratory. So the transporting is also done by the machines. And once the sample reached the laboratory, sorting of the samples is also very much important. That means we have to separate the samples for biochemistry lab are different, samples for hematology lab are different, separation of samples is different. So all this process comes under the pre-analytical automation. This is the first point. All this process comes under the pre-analytical automation. The next one is analytical automation. Once the sample reaches the laboratory, then it will get centrifuged, and the serum or plasma will be separated. Then the serum or plasma will be given to the machine, and the machine, based on our need and based on the order given by the technician, the machine will perform the test and it will give out the result. That is called as analytical automation. And after the analytical automation, the results will be coming out, and that result should be printed on a paper, and that should be delivered to the proper patient. That means the righteous patient and in the right time. That comes under the post-analytical automation. So we are using different types of machines. If you are using before the laboratory, machines before the laboratory, then that is called pre-analytical automation. If you are using the machines after the laboratory, then that is post-analytical automation. Then if you are using the machines inside the laboratory, that is analytical automation to analyze the samples. Okay, so these are the three types of automation. And today our topic is about pre-analytical automation. So what are the different types of machines we are using, and why we are using, and how they will reduce our work, we are going to learn in this session. So let us first discuss about the laboratory workflow, how the workflow will be continued inside the laboratory. So first, collection, labeling and transport of the specimens. We have to collect the sample, either it may be blood or sputum or anything. Sample we have to collect, and then we have to label it, then we have to transport the specimen to the laboratory. Okay. And next is loading of the specimens into the automated analyzers and analysis of results. Once the specimens have reached the laboratory, then we have to load the specimens into the automated analyzers. Then the analyzers will analyze the results. Then once the tests are completed, we are not supposed to discard the specimens. We have to store the specimens inside the refrigerator. By chance, if any wrong diagnosis was done, or if the doctor found something problem with the results, then the doctor will order another type of test within the sample. So every time you cannot call the patient to the laboratory, and you can't collect the blood. So what you have to do is you have to preserve the sample. So storage of specimens is also very much important. So here first one is, you can see in the picture, this is the robotic hand. Robotic hands are nowadays available in the bigger hospitals, multi-specialty hospitals. So there is no need of a phlebotomist. Like this, robotic hands will collect the blood from the patient correctly. Sometimes when the technician is is a trainee, what he will do is he will puncture the vein, and the needle will pass through the vein, and it can hit the bone, or sometimes it will hit the nerves also. If the technician is not perfect in collecting the blood, so what they will do is they will pass through the vein, and they will cross the vein, and they will hit the bone, or they will hit the nerve. They will make a puncture to the nerve, and it will if they hit the bone, it will result in the sepsis, and later off we have to cut off because the bone will get sepsis. And if it causes any damages to the nerve, then it will result in the falling of hand. So there will be no movement inside the hand. So nowadays we brought a new machine that is called robotic hand, which will collect the blood from the hand directly with the help of the laser technology. So this is the machine. This is the updates and here we are reducing the errors by collecting the sample at a proper speed. Sometimes when you are collecting the when you are trying to collect the blood from the patient, when you are pulling the plunger very fastly in the syringe, the blood will enter into the syringe, and it will hit the piston of the syringe, and it will result in the lysis of the blood. So here, with the help of laser technology, by using this robotic hand, what we are going to do is the piston here, it is pulled at a proper speed, and no RBC entering into this tube. See here, this is the tube. You can see here, it is not directly entering into the syringe. The blood is entering into a small tube, narrow tube, and from here it will enter into a syringe. Here the causing of hemolysis is very less. Okay, so this is the robotic hand we are using inside the laboratories nowadays to collect the blood sample. And next is, after collecting the sample, we have to provide an unique laboratory access and number. Okay, we have to provide a barcode. That is nothing but we have to provide a barcode for him, and that should be particularly belonging to that patient only. We cannot provide the same barcode or same unique ID number to the another patient, and record it, and label is fixed to the container when the specimen is obtained. Immediately when the patient enters into the laboratory, we have to enter all the details into the computer. Then the computer will generate a unique ID number, or the computer will generate a barcode, and that barcode we have to take it, and we have to fix to the tubes in which the patient sample is collected. Okay, you have to fix that barcode, or you have to label that barcode to the tubes in which the patient sample has been obtained. And proper alignment is important. Proper alignment is important means, so when it's sticker on the tube, it must be perfect, because after all that, the cubes are entering into the analyzers, which are fully automated. And if the tube is not containing the label properly, then the sample will be rejected and the test will be not performed properly. So that's why we have to label the tube properly, like this. So proper dressing of the sample is important. You can see two images here. There are two kids. A kid is dressed properly and another kid is not dressed properly. The kid who is dressed properly can walk freely. The kid who had not dressed properly, he cannot walk freely. The dress will be an obstruction and he may fall down. So when you are not labeling the sample properly, the fully automated machines will not identify it and they will reject that sample like this. See, this is not the proper labeling. Never label the sample like this. You have to put the barcode in a proper way. Okay, you have to put the barcode from here to here, from on one side. Not you should not turn the barcode around the tube, or you should not put the barcode as a sealer for the cap, or not in this zigzag way. Okay, this is not the proper labeling. If you label the samples like this, then the machine will reject. The machine cannot identify the detail, and the machine will reject. So immediately after collecting the blood, you have to enter the patient details, and the computer will generate a barcode. Then that barcode, you have to label it properly. Otherwise, it will result in an error. And next, what is this barcoding? What details are present inside this? This barcoding is unique for one person. It is not for the whole family, or it is not for the persons many number of persons who are suffering with the same type of disease, or it is not for the patients who are referred under the same type of doctor. Okay, it is for every single person. It is different. Barcoding is a unique ID. It is different for each and every single person. Like we are having now Aadhaar card, we are having individually. Like when you enter into the laboratory, you will have a separate barcode. Number of times you are entering into the laboratory, you will have the same barcoding. Okay, if you are visiting a hospital and if you are taking the treatment, until you get well, you will have the same barcode. Okay, the barcode is unique for you. So what details are present inside this barcode? It will contain name of the patient and age of the patient and sex, whether he is male or female, he or she, or site of sample collection. That means whether it is collected from the forearm, or whether it is from the radial artery, or whether it is collected from the capillary blood. Okay, so site of sample collection is also important. And time of sample collection, whether it is a morning sample or fasting sample or evening sample, random sample. So time of sample collection and department to which it has to be transferred, whether the blood sample belongs to the hematology or biochemistry, or where it is belonging. So we have to, the barcode will contain the department also, and type of test to be performed. Okay, I think, is it clear? The last line. Okay, the last line is types of tests we have to perform on that particular sample. This all details are present inside the barcode. Okay, so name, age, sex, site of the sample collection, time of sample collection, department, and different types of tests we have to perform on that sample. Okay, so once the sample enters into the laboratory with a proper barcode from the collection center, in the collection center, what we are going to do? Okay, this you can see a machine here. Okay, you can see a machine here. This machine is called as barcode scanner or reader. Barcode scanner or reader. You might have seen this barcode scanner or reader in many malls and shops where they are scanning all the barcodes present on the things what we are buying in the from the shops. Okay, how this barcode scanner and reader will work, I will tell you. But before that, I want to show you here. There are two types of barcode. One type is one dimensional barcode and second one is two dimensional barcode. See here, one dimensional barcode and two dimensional barcode. You can find some difference between this one dimensional and two dimensional. When it comes with the one dimensional barcode, we have to read the with the help of the scanner, you have to read it from one dimension only. When you're reading this two dimensional barcode with the help of the scanner, you can read from this side or you can read from this side. See here. Here is the example. The numbers, if the numbers are always on this side of the barcode scanner, this is the one dimensional barcode. Even if the numbers are present on this side, and if it is able to read that barcode, then that is called as two dimensional barcode. Okay, we can read it from top to top and or from the bottom. From here we can read it from only one side. Okay, the numbers will show that it is a one dimensional barcode, and if the numbers are not present and some thick lines are present at the borders, and it is showing like some hologram image, then that is called as two dimensional barcode. This is the difference. Two types of barcodes are present nowadays. Okay, both are used inside the laboratory, and this is a barcode scanner we are using to read the labels, barcodes. And how it will work, I will tell you later. So here I want to tell you one term that is called as symbology. It is the term used to describe the rules specifying the way data are encoded into the bars and spaces, as well as the number of each. It is determined by a specification for that symbology. Why we are talking about symbology? Because as I told you, when we are using this barcode scanner, how this barcode scanner is detecting the details which are present in this black and white lines, that logic is called as symbology. Okay, so let's see. It is the term used to describe the rules specifying the way the data encoded into the bars and spaces, as well as the number of each. It is determined with the specification of symbology. Different combination of bars and spaces represent the different characters. So when you are observing this barcode, you can find some lines are thick and some are thin, and some are more thicker and some are more thinner, and some are long in length and some are short in length. You can find different types of lines are present here. When you are using the barcode scanner, the laser light coming from the barcode scanner will fall on this barcode, and you can see the white area. It is not reflecting the red light backside, it is absorbing it, and the dark area, it is reflecting the light back again. You can see, if you are able to see that red light, that means it is reflecting. The laser light, when it comes from the barcode scanner, it falls on this barcode. And when the light falls on this white area, it will not go back. And when the light falls on this black area, it will reflect. And this barcode scanner, once the light falls like this, when the light falls on this dark areas, black lines, again, it will reflect back into the scanner. Inside the scanner, it will be having some detectors which will capture that reflected light. And based on that reflected light, the patient details will be digitalized. Okay, this is how the barcode scanner or reader will work, based on this dark lines and thin lines. Okay, so next is the barcode will contain the black bars and white spaces. And inside the barcode scanner, there will be a photo cell detector which will capture the reflected light from the black color, and then it will be digitalized. Then we will get the patient details. And once the patient details are obtained, and then we will transport the sample to the departments based on the test order. Like if the sample must be transported to the hematology, then we will transport that sample to the hematology. If there are some biochemical tests, then we will transport the sample to the biochemical department. So transporting is a very important procedure inside the laboratory. For transporting the samples, we are having a special type of system that is called as a pneumatic system. You can see here in the picture, this is a building, and here it is the first floor and second floor and third and fourth and fifth. If you are having a if your ground floor is the sample collection center here, then we will collect the samples. Then for every floor and for every department, there will be a proper number. Like every one of us, we are having a unique mobile number. Whenever we are dialing that mobile number, particularly the call is going to that particular person. Okay. So in the same way, every lab will be having some particular number. We will keep the samples here and we will press the number. Immediately the sample will move to the laboratory. If you press a number one, then it will go here. If you press number two here, then number three here, number four here, then number five, then it will move to here. It depends. Every lab will contain some particular number. And if you keep the sample inside that pipes, and if you press the number, then it will take the sample to that particular department based on the number you have entered for the machine. And this machine is called as the pneumatic system. It is present inside the bigger laboratories, where in the multi-speciality hospital, the ICU and operation theaters are present at the fourth and fifth floors, and laboratory is present at the ground floor. And immediately when the doctor is performing some surgery, the doctor wants to know some different types of parameters in the biochemistry. Immediately the doctor will order the nurse. Like here you can see beds are present. Okay, the doctor will order the nurse to collect the blood sample, and the nurse will collect the blood, and she will give it to the machine, and that machine will transport that samples to the laboratory here. Okay, so or here. So in this way, pneumatic system, what was the benefit of this pneumatic system is that we don't need any particular type of person to transport the, to collect these samples, and he can, there is no need to search for the lift or search for the steps. And if a person is absent for the duty, then the nurse has to go for the laboratory to transport to move these samples and to get tested. This pneumatic system, immediately it will transport the samples from ICU or from the operation theater or from the wards or from the collection center directly to the laboratory. So this is the benefit of this pneumatic system. And this is a rapid specimen transport. It will transport the specimen at a high speed, and hemolysis of sample is the drawback. Hemolysis, sometimes the machine will carry the container at a high speed, so sometimes there will be a hemolysis of the sample. And if you the sample proper package is very much important. How we are going to pack the sample, I will show you in the next image. So these are the drawbacks or disadvantages of this pneumatic system, but still we are using it with the help of a proper package and by keeping some sponge like material inside it, so that tubes will not hit the surface of the bottle, and there is the reduction of hemolysis. So we can transport the sample rapidly, very rapidly, very fastly, and we can reduce the hemolysis by introducing some type of sponge and proper package. By maintaining the proper package, we can perform the test properly. So this is the way. See here, this is blower one and this is blower two. See here, they will construct the pneumatic system inside the hospitals. And here, this is the keypad, what we are having inside the laboratory. You can select the number. If your hematology laboratory number is 789, you have to put the sample inside this laboratory. Suction bag, and when you press 789, automatically the sample will enter into this tube, and from here it will enter here, then from here it will enter, then it will reach this hematology laboratory. So whenever you are working in some hospital, there definitely they will tell you the number. Biochemistry lab number is 456, and like mobile number, we are having some different types of numbers for the laboratory. When you press the number, automatically it will suck the sample and it will make the sample to move through the tubes, and it will reach the destination. Okay, so this is the pneumatic system schematic diagram, and these are the pneumatic boxes. Okay, see here, this one is containing a blood bag, and here we are having the samples. Okay, these are the sample containing boxes, and we will keep the samples inside, and we will keep this one into this box and we will close the lid properly, and then we will keep this one inside the tube. So here in this image, see, some surgery is happening inside the lab operation theater, and the doctor needs more amount of blood, and immediately he ordered the nurse, and the nurse made a call to the laboratory blood bank, which was at a ground floor. So immediately the ground floor, the blood bank persons who are working in the ground floor, immediately what they will do is they will collect the blood bank and they will keep it in the pneumatic system and they will give it to the machine. Immediately within seconds it will reach the operation theater. If this pneumatic system was not there, then what will be the process? The nurse has to come out of the room, operation theater, and she has to call another nurse, because the person who is working in the operation theater cannot go out directly because they are wearing some sterilized dresses. So they cannot enter into the normal environment. Okay, so then they will call another nurse and they will pass the message. Then that nurse will pass the message to the ward boy. Then that ward boy has to move to the ground floor. He can wait for the lift, or sometimes he will move through the steps. If the power is not available, then he will move through the steps. Then he will reach the ground floor. Then he has to collect the blood bag. Then again, he had to climb the steps. Then he has to reach. It is a lengthy process. When we have these automated machines, we can save the time and we can reduce the manpower. Okay, we can save the time and we can reduce the manpower. So this is the benefit of this pneumatic system. We can transport the blood bags, not only these blood bags, urine samples or blood samples or CSF samples, any type of sample we can. Sometimes the medicines are also transported through this pneumatic system inside the hospital when there is an emergency. Okay, there is an emergency in the ICU which is present at the 10th floor and the medical shop is at the ground floor. So it will take some time to transport the medicines, but this pneumatic system will transport the medicines within seconds. Okay, so it works at a very high speed. So you have to close this lid properly. So this is called as proper packaging of the samples, and you have to keep these tubes properly inside this one. Okay, and here you can see the labeling of this samples here. Okay, proper labeling is important. Okay, so another type of transport is also available inside the hospital to transport the samples, that is electric track vehicles, and these are the having a large carrying capacity, and this will not cause any type of damage to the specimens and quicker in transport, but cost of making track and proper station. That means, so here these electric track vehicles are having more advantage when compared with the pneumatic system. This can carry large amount of samples, and whereas in the pneumatic system there is a disadvantage, that is called hemolysis. Here it will not cause any type of hemolysis. It is very quickly we can transport the samples. But what is the drawback? What is the disadvantages? Here you can see in this image, this is called as the station. This is called as station, and making all these pipes arrangement, okay, this is called as the working procedure. To build up all this setup, it will cost more for the electric track vehicles. To build all those ways inside the laboratories and to build up your proper station for this electric track vehicles, it is costly. It is very costly. That is the drawback. And next one is the mobile robots. and these are useful for a busy laboratory, and different models are available, and person to place the specimen and to remove the specimens. They can place the specimens now and they can remove the specimens. Now they over problem. Okay, so now we don't have any chance of hemolysis, or here we don't have any cost effective. Okay, these are coming at a low cost when compared with the pneumatic system or when compared with the electric track vehicles. They can move from one department to another department with the help of wheels which are fixed for the robots, and they can place the specimens. If any sample is present inside the robot, they can remove it and they can place it on the table. And if any samples are present on the table, they can take it and they can keep it inside them, and they can move to the destination of the laboratory. They can move to the hematology or biochemistry or everywhere. And previously they don't have this one, and now they have overcome this problem. And here you can see this mobile robot here. See, the person is keeping the samples here, then the machine will transport the samples to the desired place, whether it is the, if it is a medicine, it will transport to the ICU or operation theater or wards, or if these are the samples, then once we enter the number, then it will move to the desired place. Okay, so these are the different types of machines, pre-analytical automation, which are available nowadays in the laboratories. And these machines are used to reduce the errors, like noting the patient details properly and reducing the hemolysis of the sample. Because once after collecting the sample, if the sample gets hemolyzed, then we cannot perform the test properly for specifically for some parameters. And sometimes analyzing the blood gases is also very much important. So with the help of this electric vehicle transport or robotic transport or pneumatic system, we can perform those tests immediately whenever we need in an emergency. Okay, this is about the pre-analytical automation. Okay, so the topic is completed. If you have any doubt, you can ask me. Yes, sir. Hello. Hello. Hello.
Is there any drawback of that robotic system?
Robotic system, we don't have any drawback right now. Robotic system is the best one.
Best over all the other systems.
Yes, when compared with the electric track vehicles and when compared with the pneumatic system, robotic systems are the best things. Like the robotic systems, see, in the previous pandemic situation, in the during corona time also, no one is having no one have dared to be in touch with a corona patient to provide some service, like giving medicines or collecting the blood samples in a regular way, or to provide some food for the patients. Nobody is ready. There we are using these robots. The robotic systems are the best way. And any other doubts?
Sir, pneumatic system, once again summarize please.
So pneumatic system is nothing but it is having a set of pipes arranged in a proper way. One second. See, here you can see this is a pipeline. Okay, this is nothing but a pipeline which is built inside the laboratory. Okay, like we are having the electric wires inside the walls. Okay, there are some proper engineers for this to do this work. They will come to the laboratory and they will attach some pipes, and this is the vacuum suction cabinet which is present inside each and every laboratory. Even it is present inside the operation theater, and it is in the ICU also. Whenever you are entering, see, if ICU number is 1, 2, 3, then if you want to send some medicines, then you have to put that medicines inside and press 1, 2, 3. Immediately that machine will suck that medicines and they will transport through the pipes and they will be delivered to the ICU. If you want to if in the ICU, if they want to send some sample, and if your lab code is 456, if it is a biochemistry, if the biochemistry code is 456, what the nurse will do who is present in the ICU is she will collect the sample and they will give that sample to the suction cabinet, and that cabinet will suck the samples and they will transfer to the laboratory immediately. It will be done. This machine will work with vacuum. It works with the vacuum like this. Once you can search in the YouTube also how this pneumatic system will work. So once you see any video, then you will get you can clear your. Any other? See, directly, see, here in this image I have shown you, these are the pneumatic containers. Okay, this is the pneumatic container. In this pneumatic container, we will keep the and we will give this container to that suction cabinet. Then that suction cabinet will move this container to the ICU, or this they will move this container to the laboratory, wherever you want to send the samples or wherever you want to send the blood bag or medicine. Whenever you have entered the number, this total suction container will move, pneumatic container will move inside the tube. Okay, then they and it is delivered at the proper destination based on the number what you have entered. Any other? Yes, sir.
Students, if you have any questions, you can ask now.
Yes, sir.
Yes, Simon.
Yes. So, what are the difference between free and analytical automatons? Are they all function the same, or there's different way of using them?
Sorry. Come again.
Okay, I'm asking the difference between free and analytical automation. What are their difference?
Okay, pre-analytical and analytical automation, right?
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. See, pre-analytical means we are using some type of machines to collect the blood sample and to transport the blood. But whereas in the analytical department, we are using analyzers inside. They will perform the tests by using, okay, analytical is present inside the laboratory and pre-analytical it is present outside the laboratory. Analytical means the machines are present inside the laboratory, inside the department, and pre-analytical means those machines are present outside the laboratory and they will perform the outside procedures like collection of samples, noting down the patient details and transporting the samples to the different departments. All these procedures are coming under the pre-analytical procedures. So all this work is done by the pre-analytical machines. Whereas in the analytical, the sample will be transported to the department, and inside the department, we are giving that sample to the machine, and that machine will take the blood or serum or plasma, and it will mix with the reagents, and it will analyze that samples in the calorimeter or spectrophotometer or somewhere, and it will give the results. Analytical mission means they are present inside the laboratory, and pre-analytical they are present outside the laboratory. Is it clear, Simon?
Okay, it's clear now.
Okay, any other doubts?
Students, any more doubts? Please feel free to ask the questions.
Yeah, anyone can ask, anyone can ask. There is no restriction. Anybody can speak. Vamsi, sir?
Yes, sir.
Sir, only final year students are here?
Final year and second year students, sir. Both.
Okay, but still final years are not speaking really. I can see.
Yes, sir. Actually, final year students have a class, sir. A class is ongoing and only few students joined in this seminar, sir. Webinar.
Okay. Geetika is there. Hakikat is here.
Yes, sir.
Fatima. Okay. Parvesh, Rukaya, Tanu, Ekla.
Yes.
Hope. I think there are no more doubts, sir. I think we can end the session. Thank you. Thank you, sir, for the opportunity you have given me to share the knowledge with the students. Thank you. Thank you all for staying patiently and listening. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir. So thank you very much for being with us, sir. Yeah, the seminar is fantastic, and particularly I would like to say about pneumatic system. So it is a new thing for us to know today, sir. So thanks for letting us know about pneumatic system in the lab for rapid delivery of samples. And also you discussed about the mechanism of barcodes and symbology. So that was really interesting. And this is the first time that we are learning about how the barcode scanner works. And today we came to know that there are different types of barcodes, like one dimension and double dimension barcode systems. So it was a very interactive section, sir. So thank you very much for your webinar, and we are looking forward.
Thank you for the feedback. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So thank you very much, sir, and thank you very much, students. So on behalf of HOD, sir, I'm finishing this webinar. So thank you very much, sir. Your presence is very valuable for us. Thank you very much, students, and thank you very much, sir. Okay, I'm going to end this session. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.